Moran, I'm Head of Education and Research at FIG, and joining me today is Jake Conduction, who is Director of Fixed Income Sales. So whilst my background's very much education and research, Jake is the one on the trading desk and he has all the answers to the pricing and construction of accounts, etc., etc. So before we get underway, I'd just like to take you through a few housekeeping tips. On the right side of your screen, you should see a panel. If it's not expanded, that panel, there's probably an orange arrow. If you click on that, it will expand the panel. And about halfway down, you'll see there's a little section called questions. So whilst we're giving the webinar today, if you have any questions, please type them in and we'll try and answer them as we go along. If we don't, we'll answer more questions at the end of the session. Or again, if we run out of time, we'll email or give you a call at the end to make sure everything's understood. But now we'll get underway and I'll hand over to my colleague Jake for the introduction.
Thanks, Liz, and thanks everyone for joining us today. As Liz mentioned, my name is Jake Conduction. I work at the Brisbane desk. I'm a director of fixed income sales and been in the markets for about 20 years. And today we'd like to talk to all of you about trying to find ways to make your cash work harder. So let's get started. As you can see on your screen currently, FIG is licensed to only provide general financial product advice, so there's no consideration for your personal circumstances. We are the fixed income experts and certainly talk to you about fixed income, but whether they suit you, that's in your own court. So I'll start off by answering who is FIG. And I guess FIG was set up about 15 years ago by Jim Stenning, who had the vision of opening up the bond market here in Australia. For decades, the market was minimum $500,000 per bond, and Jim opened up that bond market to under $500,000 parcels, and I'm proud to say we're down to $10,000 parcels for a large part of that marketplace. So FIG was designed over 15 years ago to make that happen, and here we are now. We are Australia's largest fixed income specialists. We're experts. We have a research team dedicated to research and specifically on the fixed income side. We're not aligned with any other banks or larger parties, so we're dedicated to being the experts in the one area. We're very rapidly growing. We've got over 5,000 clients with 200 plus new accounts every month. These are trusts, charities, councils, a lot of self-managed super funds and individual accounts. Over $9 billion in funds under administration now, and over 15 years experience simply in the fixed income arena. So today we'd like to dispel the myths that exist in the bond market, and some of the education that we'd like to provide should hopefully dispel that those myths. In the marketplace, there's a media spin on what a good investment is, and today is all about learning the facts. So let's get started in this. What you should see in your screen right now is a pretty typical simplified risk and return graph. On the horizontal axis, you've got the risk, and on the vertical axis, there's return. And so on the higher risk category are the property and shares. So you take higher risk and you expect higher returns. And conversely, the lower risk is the term deposit and bond space. So the term deposit and bond space, this is the kind of stuff that keeps you asleep at night, your term deposit and bonds. And on the property and share side, that's the type of stuff where you expect your higher return. So in the middle, you'll see the hybrids are indicated in the middle. And that's there because we see as a hybrid as a mix of stock and a bond. So moving to the property side, property certainly has its charms and certainly has been an exceptional return of the last 20, 30 years here in Australia. But of course, the downside with property is the illiquidity. You can't sell down 5 or 10% of your investment unit to cover a nice holiday overseas. Maintenance costs can also be a bit of a drag on the property. And sometimes tenants, of course, can be difficult. But overall, liquidity is the major drag for the property area. Shares certainly have liquidity, especially in the good times, but it's the volatility that you have to accept to capture those higher returns. And also in the property and share area, you're looking at unknown returns. You expect a higher return. Certainly the timing of when you buy and sell for both those asset classes are highly levered, or probably highly correlated to your ultimate return. On the other side are the term deposits and the bond space. And term deposits certainly have very, very safe and stable returns for you, but it's quite a low return, especially after considering where inflation is. I guess typical TDs anywhere from 3 to 4% type returns these days, and with inflation tracking about 2.6 or 2.7, that total return to you is getting a bit meager, the real return. In the TD space, liquidity is also quite low. But for that ultra safety and for that lack of liquidity, you have to give up these. You have to give up returns. So it's the risk-reward trade-off there. There is an area that we're going to concentrate a lot on here today, and that's an area we can play it safe and offer some very good returns, anywhere from 6 to 7%, and can be bought in $10,000 parcels for a large number of them. That's the bond space. So you're able to play it safely. It offers you 6 to 7% type returns, and diversification benefits, which I believe that Liz will get into some of the details later on, but the diversification away from the share market is one of the major features. So here's an asset class that offers you good safety, good returns, diversification away from the equity market, and can be bought and sold in $10,000 increments. So this is an asset that we're going to cover a lot of today, and you've got to ask yourself why the media don't cover it. So let's dig a little bit deeper. So on your screen right now, you should see a number of logos, and imagine everyone listening in certainly would recognize those logos. These are major companies across not only Australia but around the world: NAB, BHP, Telstra, AXA, Rabobank, Woolies, Suncorp. So companies that have been around for decades and probably will last for more decades to come. They also happen to be some of the major bond issuers here in Australia and around the world. And of course, these bonds have been trading for decades here in Australia, but unfortunately, not many people here in Australia have really accessed them. So let's get into it. What is a bond? It's basically an IOU from one of these companies. You're lending money to NAB, you're lending money to Telstra, and that's simply a loan to these companies. The bond market is huge. There are some estimates it's twice to 3 to 4 times bigger than the share markets. It's at least twice as big as the share market. So it's a very, very large marketplace. The typical overseas portfolio can be anywhere from 20 to 50% towards the fixed income area. I guess the average is anywhere from 20 to 50%. But unfortunately, here in Australia, the average SMSF has less than 1% in bonds. The question I ask is, why is that? Is there some kind of secret club? I don't want to start any conspiracy theories here, but some kind of secret club that trades these assets? Anyway, let's dig a little bit deeper. Well, the minimum was $500,000 per bond. So any of those bonds you saw, or those companies you saw on the prior slide, they certainly did trade bonds in $500,000 parcels for decades. Now, FIG opened its doors over 15 years ago to open up that bond market to investors like yourselves. We broke up that secret club. FIG pioneered opening up the bond market. We had the vision decades ago to open up the bond market from $500,000 to $10,000 parcels. Well, guess what? That day is today. We can now buy and sell bonds in $10,000 increments. So let's see why things have changed the last few years. On the demand side, there's investors like yourselves on that are listening in that are quite attracted to bonds. They're looking for the higher returns. Term deposits are getting quite meager, and so people are attracted to those higher 6 to 7% returns. They're looking for the lower risk assets. They're looking for the diversification benefits away from the equity side. And they want to be able to buy and sell in smaller parcels, in $10,000 parcels. So they're looking for those types of attributes, and that is found in the bond market. On the other side, why is corporate Australia supplying these things? Well, they're trying to diversify away from the banks. They want to extend out their loans. A typical bank will offer you 1 year, 2 year, 3 year type loans. They want to extend out these loans, and they also want to get some diversification away from the banks. So they're turning to the corporate bond market. So these two supply-demand metrics, the supply coming from corporate Australia and the demand coming from the investors are being met, and the bond market's expanding quite rapidly. So I'd like everyone to open your minds and learn a lot more about this exceptional asset class. And who better to learn from than Ms. Elizabeth Moran, who's Australia's leading expert on the corporate bond space. She's a columnist for the Australian Smart Income columnist, a regular contributor to the Eureka Report, the Australian Financial Review, many other business media, as well as the ASX, I believe. The head of education research here at FIG, and proud to say my colleague, Ms. Elizabeth Moran.
Thanks very much, Jake. I look at that photo, and that photo's been around for a while, and I just want to get a texture and, you know, put glasses on myself and give myself a mustache. So let's keep going. Let's get that off the screen. Okay, what is a bond? As Jake said, a bond is just a loan. You are lending the company your money. Because it's a loan, it's a legal obligation, and they must pay you your interest and principal when they say they're going to. Now, that's a great investment for particularly retirees who are looking for that income stream. So you know when those interest payments will be in your account, and equally you know when that money will be returned to you. I think it's really important that it is a legal obligation, because when we compare bonds to shares, there is no obligation for shares, a dividend, if you like. There's no obligation to pay a dividend, and there is no guarantee of any amount being returned to you at any future point. So with a bond, an investment in bonds, you're a banker, you take on the role of banker, if you like, and an investment in shares, you're taking on the owner role. So why would you buy shares? Well, you'd buy shares because you were hoping that the share price would grow and that the dividend price would grow. So one of the fundamental metrics, if you like, is growth. So you're looking for growth. Bonds are different. Bond holders aren't necessarily looking for growth. What they're looking for is consistency, if you like, in income, but also survivability. That's one of the key terms I'll use. So if a company can survive, it's going to pay you your interest and principal when they say it's going to. So that gives you a lot of comfort as a bondholder. There's quite a few things I would look for as an analyst. One is the size of the company. So bigger companies generally have access to greater resources. So they might have access to undrawn debt facilities from banks or loans from banks. They often also have large shareholders, which might be willing to provide additional equity if the company got into trouble. But they'll also have quite a good range of assets usually that they might be able to sell. So if they got into some difficulty, they could sell assets, and then of course they could repay bondholders, or you know, those people that had lent money to the company. So factors that will see a company survive, if you like, are really important to bondholders. Very much less so to equity holders, because they're interested in that growth. And in fact, in the last reporting season, you would have seen a few of the companies whose growth didn't meet expectations. Their share price fall rapidly. Metcash and Silvershare were two of those that I can think of. So the consistency of bonds, that knowing that the interest payments will be into your bank account at certain days and principal will be returned to you, is very important and gives us a lot of confidence. We have a question here from Ross, and he's saying, how best can we judge the risk profile in bonds, the quality of the company issuing? That's a good question, Ross. At FIG, we actually write a lot of research, and our research papers can be 10 or 12 pages or even more in some cases, where we talk about the company, why we like the company, the strengths of the company, but also the risks. So we really want to identify risks for our clients and let them be their own judge, if you like. Certainly if there's any bonds where we have in the past recommended them and we've changed our mind on them, we let our clients know. We certainly through our weekly publication, The Wire, but also through the dealers. The dealers would be on the phone to you saying our view of this bond has changed. So we are actually also continuously watching the companies and the bonds that we've recommended. Okay, so let's move on from this slide. What is a bond? Now, bond facts, quite interesting. As many people don't know about the market, I think it's really important that we just describe it very broadly. So the global bond market is larger than the global share market. And as Jake said, it's at least double and possibly larger than double. The vast majority of bonds on issue are issued by governments, or sovereigns as we'd call them. And in fact, in the Australian market, the Australian Commonwealth Government is the largest issuer and has approximately $265 billion worth of bonds on issue. Now, we estimate the total Australian market to be $1 trillion, very substantial market. Now, that's just all the companies that issue Australian dollar-denominated bonds, because a lot of Australian companies also issue bonds in foreign currencies. So if we add those Australian companies that have issued in foreign currencies, we actually can add approximately another $500 billion to that total size of the market, which would take it to $1.5 trillion. Now, there's a couple of things with bonds. Some of them are quite long dated, and that shouldn't bother you too much because it's a tradable market. You can buy and sell bonds. You don't have to hold to maturity. And in fact, we estimate about half of our investors trade bonds. They're not hold to maturity investors. That's still okay as well if you're happy with the income and happy to see that continuously coming into your account and know that maturities are in a few years' time, that's fine too, to be a hold to maturity investor. But so they are liquid instruments. Bonds are liquid. You can sell prior to maturity. There's some of the one of the main advantages over term deposits, as well as that higher return. Now, with bonds, there is also an opportunity for an additional gain or loss over and above expected returns. And that's because bonds, when they're first issued, we talk about bonds being in terms of their $100 face value. So we say they've got $100 face value. But in the market, bond prices move up and down, and they can trade above their $100 face value, and they can trade below their $100 face value. So if you bought a bond when it's first issued at $100, and a few years ago, Stockland issued a bond, a fixed rate bond, paying 8.25%. So what's happened with that bond over the time, interest rates have come down, and investors' expectations of their returns have come down, but it's meant they've been prepared to pay more for that income stream on that Stockland bond. So that Stockland bond now, to buy that bond in the secondary market, is approximately $120. So if you bought that bond at first issue and still held it, it's now worth $120. You can sell that bond and make a $20 gain if you like. So there is an opportunity for capital gain. Equally, if you're a forced seller in the market and the bonds you hold are trading at less than $100, then you may make a loss, because you're selling before your bonds reach maturity when you would expect that $100 to be returned to you. So if you sell prior to maturity, there is a chance for a loss, as I mentioned, but the backstop with bonds is that if you hold to maturity, and as long as that company survives, you will get your $100 back. So it's not like a dot-com bubble, for example, where you can lose the lot. Typically, we'd expect with all the bonds we recommend to that you receive your $100 face back at maturity. So you have that comfort, if you like. You have that comfort and that knowledge that you can hold the bonds and not incur that loss. So when investors first come to us, they say, well, how much should we hold in bonds? And there's a couple of indicators, if you like, that we look at. One of the things we look at is the OECD each year publishes a survey from 29 countries of their pension fund allocations. So it's where their pension funds, how they're allocated. Now, the average from all of those 29 countries' allocation to bonds is 53%. Now, in Australia, our pension fund allocation in 2013, last year, was just 9%. So we're severely, if you like, compared to the global stage, under allocating to bonds. So one of the things that won't surprise you to know is that we actually over allocate to shares. Of those 29 countries, we have the highest allocation to shares, but we also have the highest allocation to cash. And that's because we think investors are using cash as their only defensive asset class when they actually should be allocating to bonds as well as cash. Now, one of the things we do say to individual investors is that think about owning your age in bonds. And that's because as you age, as you get older, you need to be more protective of your capital and that you don't have the time to make up any losses. So you can imagine those investors that were about to retire in 2007, we were hit with the GFC, they might have lost up to 40% of their capital that they'd accumulated over their working life. They needed to be more protective and have a greater defensive allocation. So let's move on.
Looks like there's a couple of questions forming here. Yes. One of the questions refers to, is there any way to access more research to the bond issuer? And certainly there are on our website. There's quite a few resources on our website. One of the tabs would be education and research, and there's a wonderful wealth of articles as well as research reports available on our website. Or, of course, just ringing us at any time. You can certainly we can certainly forward through anything you might, any questions you might have. All the sales staff are quite well versed on all the research in the companies, so feel free to give us a ring, or we're certainly on our website. It's right there for you. Just hand it back to Liz.
Yep, great. We will try and get to the questions as we go along, and please keep sending them in, but I'll keep my momentum going at this point. So there are three types of bonds, interestingly. One of the common myths or misconceptions at the moment is that you wouldn't buy bonds in a low interest rate environment. And we think that that's mostly people's lack of understanding of bonds and the different protections they can offer. Certainly, I think those commentators are talking about the US government bonds or US treasuries, where the rates of return are so low, in fact, very close to zero, that the risk from here is that interest rates in the US will rise, and what will happen to that bond price will fall. And again, I think it's really those big traders with big exposures on their books. It's not in reference to individual investors in Australian corporate bonds. Now, one of the reasons you would still buy bonds at this point in the market is if you thought, for example, interest rates might go lower. Again, there's other reasons, but let's start with the first type of bond, the fixed rate bond. So as I was talking earlier about that Stockland fixed rate bond with an 8.25% interest rate, you can imagine that bond with its ongoing interest payments is very attractive to investors. So investors in this environment will keep paying and pay more than that $100. Now, that is because that 8.25 interest rate, if you like, Stockland pays 8.125 cents or $4.12.5 each half year. So investors know they're going to get that $4.12 each half year until the bond matures, when they'll recoup their $100 at maturity. So as I mentioned, investors will pay more. Again, if interest rates do rise, we would expect the prices on those bonds to come down. Again, if we thought it was going to go below $100, it might be wise to sell some of those bonds or sell out of them entirely and invest in something else. So the second type of bond is a floating rate bond. And these bonds are more attractive at the low point in the market, when we think interest rates have hit their low point. So it's exactly as the name suggests. Your interest income will go up and down with the economy. So these bonds are tied to a benchmark, and in Australia it's called the bank bill swap rate. And in essence, that bank bill swap rate is the bank's forward projections of interest rates. So banks, every day, there's a panel of about 14, they project interest rates for out to 30 years. So these floating rate bonds, when they're first issued, the very first day they're issued, they take the bank bill swap rate, they say this is the bank bill swap rate, 90-day bank bill swap rate today. So your interest income will be this benchmark rate plus a fixed margin over that benchmark. So the floating rate bonds have the benchmark plus a margin. So if we were looking at one today, the BBSW is about 3%. And if you had a fixed margin on top of that of 3%, your interest would be 6% for the coming quarter. So you know what your interest payment will be for each coming quarter, but as you are paid interest quarterly, they reset the interest rate for the coming period. I hope that makes sense. Okay, the third type of bond is an inflation-linked bond. These are linked to the CPI. So there's two types of bonds here. The first one is a capital index bond. Now, if you remember, I talked about $100 face value. So all bonds are issued with $100 face value. Pretty well, they're all issued $100 face value. So the capital index bonds issued with $100 face value, and each quarter, the inflation rate is added to that face value. So that $100 grows over time. So the most recent announcement of annual inflation was 2.9%. So if we bought an inflation-linked bond for $100 a year ago, inflation over the last year has been 2.9%, we would expect the face value of that bond to be now worth $102.90. So that if the company who issued the bond had to repay you today, they would owe you $102.90 and not the $100 when it was originally issued. So one of the companies that issue these types of bonds is Sydney Airport. And Sydney Airport issued a 2020 bond, I think 2004, yeah, 2004. And the face value on that bond now is about $130. So that if Sydney Airport had to repay you now, they would owe you $130 and not $100. I'm hoping that makes sense to everyone. The really attractive thing, if you like, at the moment with these bonds is that the fixed margin over inflation, or the interest rate that they pay you over inflation, is about 3.75% on those Sydney Airport bonds. So that 3.75% is paid each quarter, but it's paid on the growing face value. So it's not paid on the $100, it's paid on the $130 now. So you're, not only is your capital, your $100 linked to inflation, but so is your income. So you're getting inflation protection in two ways there. Okay, the second type of inflation-linked bond is called an index annuity bond, and these work quite differently. You pay your lump sum investment up front, and then the company returns to you principal and interest quarterly. So you're getting back your capital and your interest every quarter, and that base payment, what's known as a base payment, is linked to inflation. So these are great bonds if you're in retirement looking for a cash flow. So they're going to pay you a quarterly principal and interest, and that will grow with inflation. So that at maturity with those bonds, the company doesn't owe you anything. They've repaid you in full. The other type of bond, that capital index bond, that value grows over time, and at the end at maturity, the company owes you a greater amount than that original $100 face value invested. So you can see the first type of bond, that capital index bond, we think is better for people in accumulation phase. And the index annuity bond repaying you the principal and interest every quarter linked to inflation, we think that's better for investors in retirement because it gives you that known cash flow. Okay, so we have another couple of questions. Steve's asking, what's the current interest rates for a 12-month bond? Well, Steve, interest on bonds varies, and the longer that you're prepared to invest for bonds, typically the better the interest rates. There's not too many now that mature in one year's time, but again, you would buy a bond, or you could buy a bond and take the income and then sell the bond in 12 months' time. You would be subject to the change in price of the bond, but that is one way you can access if you just want a 12-month period. A couple of the bonds that we like at the moment are some new floating rate bonds, and that's because the margins that they've issued over and above the bank bill swap rate are very attractive. So there's one particular one that I like. It's a Bendigo and Adelaide floating rate bond, and it's paying about 5.6%. Again, you could buy that bond, hold it for a year and sell, but we couldn't be sure of what your final repayment or final return would be unless you held that bond to maturity, when we would project what that would be. Okay, I'm going to keep going here. Next slide. So, capital structure. To my mind, this is the most important slide of the presentation, and if you can understand this capital structure, you'll go a long way to understanding the principles behind the asset class. So what this shows is the priority of payments in liquidation for a bank, wind-up or liquidation for a bank. So what happens is, you imagine a bank's in trouble, it goes into wind-up. Receivers come in, they start selling down the assets, and they start repaying the investors. So the investors at this top of this structure get repaid first, and they are the lowest risk in the capital structure. Now, each rung on the ladder must be repaid before investors on the next rung receive any funds. So as we're going down each ladder on this structure, we're taking on more risk, and you would expect to be being paid more. So I'm just going to click here. Here's where the bond sits. So there's three spots here that bonds sit. So bonds sit at the very top. We have senior secured bonds or covered bonds. Now there, in Australia, the banks have to set aside 8% of their mortgage loan pool, and that's the security for those bonds. Now if for any reason the bonds in that mortgage loan pool start to default, the banks are obliged to replenish the pool, so it never goes below 8%. But of course, the way the bonds are structured, the banks can never entirely lend the whole value of the pool. So just like a mortgage where you can only borrow 70% to fund your house, very similar with these bonds. They can only borrow a certain amount against that pool. So these are very, very low risk investments, and in fact they're AAA rated in Australia, so they're rated the same as the Commonwealth Government. Very, very low risk. Moving down the ladder are term deposits. Very low risk, of course. You know when you're going to get your money back. You also know your return up front. There is no possible, they're not liquid. You can sometimes break the contract with the bank, but often there's penalty. They'll charge you penalty interest. Low risk, not actually, of course there's a government guarantee, but that's not actually in the bank's own structure, that government guarantee. That sits outside the structure. Next on the list is senior debt or senior bonds. Senior bonds sit here. So typically in Australia, senior bonds are issued for 5 years. You know when you're going to get your interest payment, so fixed rate bonds pay half yearly, and the floating rate and inflation linked pay quarterly. So you know when your interest payments will hit your account. You also know after 5 years that you should expect to get your capital, your $100 repaid to you. Low risk, tradable investments. Moving down the structure, again we're taking on a little bit more risk. We get to subordinated bonds. Now these are one rung lower on the structure. They also have longer final maturity dates. So subordinated bank bonds typically have 10 years until maturity. Now banks recognise that investors didn't want to lend for 10 years. So most of these bonds have what's known as a call date. And that is after 5 years, the bank has the option to repay you. And in fact, in Australia, most investors have expected that the bank would repay you after 5 years, but there is that chance that the investment can go for longer, and it can go for out for another 5 years to 10 years. So the longer the term to maturity of your investment, the greater the uncertainty. You don't know what's going to happen with a company in 10 years, and you're quite a bit more certain that a company would survive, if you like, after 5 years. So you have that that more certainty with shorter dated investments. So coming down to hybrids, now hybrids are quite a complex group, and just about every hybrid I've looked at has a different risks and terms and conditions. So we say to all of our investors, if you're invested in hybrids, make sure you understand exactly what the risks are, because they're pretty well all different. So with some hybrids, you have that call dates, like the subordinated debt, but it's longer. So recent ANZ listed hybrid had two soft call dates. I think 8 and 10 years were the soft call dates, but it had nearly 60 years, I think it was 60 years until final maturity. So I don't know about you guys out there, I'm not going to be here in 60 years. In essence, what that means is you have to sell to recoup your capital, and you don't know what price those hybrids are going to trade at, so you don't actually know your returns. The other thing with hybrids is, particularly the bank hybrids, they're what's known as non-cumulative. So non-cumulative means that if they miss an interest payment, and they're quite able to miss an interest payment, they don't ever have to repay you. So you have uncertainty with your income there, but you also have uncertainty with those call dates, whether the bank will call the hybrids at those dates. And if not, then you hold a very long-dated investment. In effect, it's perpetual. So it means you have to sell to recoup your capital. And of course, the last structure on the diagram are shares. Again, there's no responsibility ever to pay a dividend, although we expect companies to pay dividends, but they can be cut. They don't have to pay them. And there is never any commitment to repay you any of your capital whatsoever. So you can see shares are the highest risk in the structure, so you would expect the highest returns. You expect you're taking on those risks, you expect to be rewarded appropriately. So as an analyst, that's what I'm looking for in this structure. I'm looking for the best return given the risk. If I was just looking for the best return, I would only ever be invested in the shares, because that's where I would expect the best return. Now, to give you an example, a few years ago, the Commonwealth Bank issued some covered bonds right at the top of that structure in that senior secured debt position. And they were issued at the bank bill swap rate, so they were floating rate, bank bill swap rate, plus a margin of 1.75%. Now, at the time, that was undoubtedly the best return for the risk in the structure, to the point where those same bonds now are trading at you have to pay more for those bonds, and the return you would get on those bonds now is the bank bill swap rate, or BBSW, plus 0.4%. So bonds are trading at a nice premium. You could have sold and taken a higher than expected return, but that's the sort of thing I'm looking for. I'm not looking for the best return. I'm looking for the best return given the risk. Just wanted to show you, see I've clicked on the screen, and you see a fixed income tabs come up on this capital structure. So here at FIG, we are a fixed income specialist, so we cover all of these levels in the capital structure. So we cover term deposits. We have a term deposit brokerage business where we speak to about 60 authorised deposit-taking institutions every day to get the best term deposit rates for our clients. So one thing I like to say to clients is that banks will rarely be loyal to you. Rarely will they give you the best rate for your TDs. And if you shop around and go back to them and say, oh, FIG are offering me an extra 0.25%, can you match that? They typically will, but you might get sick of doing that at some point and bring your TD funds to FIG, where we will look after you and make sure we source the best rates for you. Now, the other section there is hybrids, and we do trade in over-the-counter hybrids. So That's very much where our company's focused, in the bigger over-the-counter range of investments. And there are a number of banks and other organisations that have listed over-the-counter hybrids. So these hybrids don't have the terms and conditions of the new bank and insurance hybrids. So some of those sorts of terms and conditions, one of them is called a non-viability trigger, and that's applicable to subordinated bonds and hybrids, and that's at the regulator APRA's discretion. So APRA can say, we think this bank is no longer viable, and then what happens to investments in those two rungs, the hybrids and the subordinated debt, they convert to shares. So they convert to shares to support the higher ranked investors in the structure and to support the bank. So you're taking on, if you buy those investments at this point, you are taking on the possibility or a risk, if you like, that they can convert to shares, and then you're in that first loss position. So shares always, if losses are incurred, the shareholders are wiped out first and it moves up. The reverse is also true, where the application of losses is from the bottom up. So again, the higher you sit in that structure, the safer your investment. Now we do have a few more questions. One from Michael, he says, where does that Bendigo bond sit in the structure that I was talking about? It's subordinated debt, Michael. It sits at that subordinated debt level. It does have that non-viability clause, but we are confident in the Bendigo and Adelaide Bank. So that does enable us to come down that structure for that higher return. So there are a couple of other things. Susan's asked, does the capital structure apply to corporate bonds? It very much does. Each corporation has its own capital structure. Of course, it doesn't have term deposits sitting in there. It may have hybrids and it may have subordinated debt, but not typically. But yes, it does have, each entity has a capital structure, and it's very important to get your hands on that capital structure and understand where your investment sits in that structure. There's a couple of questions in regards to fees and title of the bonds, but we might leave those till the end of the session, and I'll ask Jake to talk you through those. And there was another question about the net present value of the principal of the bond from Robert. So in essence, the market actually values bonds daily, and the price of the bond reflects the market's value of the bond. So because the price moves up and down, if you think about buying something in the secondary market and you pay, say you pay more for a bond, you buy that Stockland bond for $120, the return to you is going to be lower than that 8.25% that was offered at first issue. So but every day we get different prices for bonds, and that in effect is the market's estimation of the net present value of the bond. Okay, let's keep moving from here. What I wanted to do was show you how the capital structure works or translates in the market. So what I've done here, it's a snapshot of the worst possible time. I think all of us like to be optimistic, myself included, but we don't often reflect on what's the worst thing that can happen. So in essence, this is what this graph does. So we make the assumption we invest $100 on the 29th of December 2007 in three different Commonwealth Bank securities. So the very top line is senior debt. That dark blue line, senior debt. And you can see it's very gently upward sloping. Excuse me, not too many ups and downs. Now, if you remember, I said the senior debt only went for 5 years. So we actually assume one bond matures here, Commonwealth Bank bond matures, and reinvest the total proceeds in another bond. But you can see very little volatility. And in fact, these bonds were offered a flight to quality, if you like, during the GFC. Investors bought these bonds because they consider them such low risk. So very gently upward sloping that senior bond there. Now the mid blue point, or the blue line, the lighter blue line, is the CBA Pearl 3 hybrid. So you can see a little bit more volatility if you run your eye along that line. Now if you're a forced seller in about March 09, one of the worst possible times there, you would have lost about 30% of the value of your capital. However, after that, the hybrid recovers somewhat. You see a few peaks and troughs there. Interestingly, if you run your line out to the end, the hybrid is still underperforming the senior bond. Not actually what you would expect if you go back to that capital structure diagram, because you would have expected the hybrid to be returning more than the senior bond because it's higher risk. Okay, the last line, the grey line, is the Commonwealth Bank shares. Again, you can see, just running your eye very generally over that line, quite a lot more ups and downs, quite a lot more volatility. At the low point, about February 09, had you invested that $100, you would have lost about 50% of the value of your investment. I should have said up front that these lines actually include the interest on the bonds and the dividend payments on the shares, but no franking credits. Not everyone can get franking credits, so we don't include them. Okay, so again, had you been a forced seller at the worst point with the Commonwealth Bank shares, you would have lost 50% of the value of your investment. Quite shocking, I think. Anyway, from that point, the shares have recovered, which is nice to see, nearly hit the senior bond in March, maybe May 10, did overtake the bond at the end of December 2012, and have outperformed since. That is what we would have expected. I think one of the most interesting things about this graph is, though, that as an analyst, when I look at the ASX 200, what is the lowest risk company on the whole of the ASX? I would say the Commonwealth Bank. So here's what happened to the lowest risk company on the ASX. Now, I don't need to, or maybe you can anyway, imagine what would have happened to some of those big single miners or single mining services companies. A lot more cyclical, a lot more volatile, losses would have been more substantial. I think one of the very important things to highlight with this graph is that it's really important to diversify your portfolio, to hold low-risk assets, of course still to hold high-risk assets because they should generate the growth and the higher returns. But had you, for example, during the GFC, hold Commonwealth Bank senior bonds, you could have sold quite comfortably without loss of value, and then perhaps held on to your more volatile investments for a point when you think they would have returned to their normal value, if you like. Okay, let's move to the next slide. This next slide compares the S&P ASX 200 Accumulation Index. So that's the top 200 stocks on the ASX, and that accumulation index includes dividend payments, so it adds back dividend payments. We compare that accumulation index to the UBS Composite Bond Index. So UBS have for many years tracked the performance of Australian bonds. And that index is predominantly made up of government securities. About 70% of the index is government securities, and the remaining 30% is corporate bonds. So the grey line there is the UBS Composite Bond Index. You can see, again, very gently upward sloping, a little uptick there, September 08. That's when those fixed rate government bonds are very much outperformed at that point, but then again it reverts very gently upward sloping. Now if we look at the S&P ASX 200 Accumulation Index, that's the navy line. So for quite a few years on this graph it underperforms. Again, the reason I think that's the case over this period is because inflation was high over this period, and the Commonwealth government were issuing bonds at very high returns or issuing inflation-linked bonds. So these bonds really outperformed. Again, you see the S&P 200 accumulation index. It starts to take off September 02, thereabouts, a peak, then quite a significant trough. It goes up and down, and eventually this graph actually goes out to March 2014, so it's fairly recent, even though it doesn't show on the x-axis there. But the shares do eventually outperform. So what's interesting here, it's a 25, almost a 25-year graph. S&P ASX 200 accumulation returns over that period, 9.16%, so very close to that 10% over time that we all hear about. UBS Composite Bond Index over the same period, 8.72%. So there's not even half a percent difference over 25 years in what your returns would be. I think it's very interesting, and that isn't what I would have expected. I would have expected the shares to outperform by a greater percentage, especially given the much higher risk if you're comparing them to government bonds, largely government bonds over that period. Very interesting. So now I've got a few questions for you. My first is, what is your risk appetite? Quite like this photo of this lady on the screen, because I look at that hamburger and think, no way would I eat that. Those calories and the sloppy cheese, but look at her eyes. She's just really looking forward to it. So I'm flipping the question to you really today. Instead of focusing on returns, I'm thinking of you, wanting you to assess your risk. What is your risk appetite? How much risk do you have in your portfolio? Is it suitable for your goals, for the goals you have for yourself? Okay, higher risk does mean an increase volatility, increased chance of volatility, and also an increased risk of loss. Again, I'm sure you all know people during the GFC who did lose a substantial portion of their capital and have never recovered. I certainly do. And just finally, just a reminder that a loss of capital, you lose capital now, can wipe out your future income and your earnings and can impact your lifestyle. So what I would urge you all to do is think protectively of your investments. Think, what do you need to live well, to live to the standard you're used to, and to think about setting that aside into defensive assets such as cash and bonds. And on that note, I will hand back to Jake, who will round off the presentation, and then we will go to questions at the end.
Well, thanks, Liz. That was great. So I guess we're going to get into my kind of area. What I cover is the actual market side. I'm there watching it every day, watching the asset prices move and the credit profiles, and Liz and her extensive and very experienced team helps me assess the credits on a daily basis. But let's get into some of the current opportunities, and I guess I just wanted to reflect on a client I built a portfolio for last week. It was a fellow had 50,000 to invest, and I wanted to build a nice diversified portfolio, so we customized the portfolio for what he was looking for. And in that portfolio, we put in the three types of bonds that Liz touched on, the fixed, the floating, and the inflation-linked. And this is to ensure that we could take on all kinds of scenarios that are coming at us. Certainly, there are a lot of investors that believe that interest rates will continue upwards from here, that we have no more room to move down. But who knows? The future is unknown, and that's certainly something that I learned 17 years ago in the trading pits, is that no one knows what the future brings. So designing an overall portfolio with the three types of bonds covers you for all kinds of scenarios. But of course, if you have the vision that interest rates will be cut or will be climbing, or if inflation is going to take off, we can customize your portfolio to you. So I'll be back to this to Fred that I built a portfolio for last week, $50,000 spread across five different bonds, $10,000 apiece, and it kicked out about 6.28%. It was quite a good, solid, safe portfolio, and covered all the bases with the three types of bonds. And some of the bonds that were in that portfolio are these current opportunities, these top picks. So starting off with Qantas, and Liz touched on the capital structure. This is the senior debt for the company, so it sits at the very top of the capital structure of this company. Of course, many folks would be familiar with Qantas. It's Australia's largest airline here in Australia, with about 65% of the marketplace with their Jetstar and Qantas divisions. Started in the 1920s, and certainly a very, very high, nice return at 6.35%, available in $10,000 parcels to be bought and sold through FIG. Moving on to another bond that we touched on during the presentation, that was Bendigo and Adelaide. We touched on this bond. Again, this one's also available in $10,000 parcels to be bought and sold. Quite an attractive floating rate position. This is the subordinated debt. Now, unfortunately, in finance, there's a lot of jargon, and I've made it one of my directives to try to cut back the jargon. Subordinated debt gets called lots of things. Subordinated debt, junior bonds, I guess, is my preferred term. It's not senior, it's the junior, so second below the top as far as capital structure is concerned. It's an ASX top 60 company with divisions on the retail side, business side, big mortgage divisions, and this is a wonderful offering, 5.63%, $10,000 parcels, and looks quite attractive in my eyes. And so moving into, I guess, my final top pick currently, the Sydney Airport Capital Index Bond. Liz touched on a capital index bond, and this is an inflation-linked capital index bond where your capital value, your principal value, climbs along the way. Also available in $10,000 parcels, this bond kicks out a return of 6.8%. This is a senior secured credit, so this is actually backed by assets, so the very, very top of the capital structure, and again, quite an attractive asset available to be bought and sold in $10,000 parcels. So overall, Fred's portfolio that I designed last week kicks out a nice 6.3, somewhere in that range is what we were able to get for his portfolio. Quite an attractive opportunity overall. So the next steps for everyone online is to learn more. Sign up for The Wire. It's our free weekly newsletter dedicated to fixed income. That's all it covers. You probably get a lot of investment type letters coming to your inbox, but typically none of them are going to be dedicated to the fixed income area, so the term deposit, bond space. We cover the companies we like, new issues that are coming out, our expectations for the future, inflation data, all kinds of things are covered in there. It's our weekly free news piece, and certainly would encourage everyone to sign up for that letter. I would also encourage everyone to open an account. There is no downside. It gives you the ability to act. There's no cost or obligation to have the account open, but it just allows you to act on that basis. Also, getting your account open gives you the online access. And online access is actually quite well advanced here. I hear a lot of kudos from existing clients saying that our online is quite advanced and quite good. You can also get the daily pricing online for all the bonds we trade, or the majority of the bonds we trade on a regular basis. Your monthly statements will be there. Your assets will be there. There's also a nice summary of cash flows expected to be paid from your existing portfolio. So opening up an account, again, costs nothing, gets you set up and ready to act. You can start acquiring some of those Sydney airports, which I find extremely attractive and quite safe. And signing up online allows you to see the online pricing right away. So no downside, gives you the ability to act. I'd also encourage everyone to meet their FIG relationship manager. We've got a team in Perth, Melbourne, Sydney, and of course, here in Brisbane, we've got a nice team as well, which I sit on. And all of us are fixed income experts dedicated to helping you out, just trying to find the best assets, the safest assets to satisfy your safety needs. And I'd also encourage everyone to start investing, start considering adding a fixed income to your overall portfolio. There's a giant universe of bonds out there, and there was a question that came out I'd love to touch on from Peter. He mentioned that we just trade over-the-counter bonds and nothing ASX listed. I think that was the intonation of his question. And to be honest, the bond market is, the over-the-counter bond market is so much larger, but 95% of the bond market is over-the-counter, and the ASX listed stuff is simply about 5% of the marketplace. You're really giving up. So again, consider opening up the account, talk to a FIG expert, and thanks everyone for your time. Let's find ways to make your cash work harder for you.
Excellent, Jake. Thank you very much for that. We've got a number of questions here from Ross and Shazzy, Norman and Stephen, all about how they go about opening an account, what the fee structure is for FIG, how FIG makes its money. That's a very good question. And there's a couple of other questions, but perhaps do you want to just talk about opening an account first, Jake, and the fee structure? That'd be great.
Yeah, sure, Liz. It's certainly that on the fee side, it's a question that crops up quite regularly. The bond market around the world, the way that bond dealers make money is off of a spread. When you buy or sell a bond through a dealer, they're taking a little clip. So exactly like when you go to your bank and you want to buy U.S. dollars, and they quote you 110. You want to buy U.S. dollars, it's 110. They're sourcing that currency at 109.90, and they sell it to you at 110. So that's one way that the bond market makes money, is that we take little spreads on the bid or the offer. So all those current top pick numbers that we had posted, that includes our fees. So having an account open and available, there's no cost to do so. If you buy or sell, it's already worked in any time I show you a bid or an offer. So if you come to me and you want to sell, I'll show you a bid price, and in that price is our commission essentially, and same thing on the offer side. I guess about 0.1, 0.2% is pretty normal. And as far as opening up an account, very, very simple. Take you 5 minutes to get it done. Again, you know, certainly meeting with your FIG expert and having your paperwork done will take you 5 minutes to get the paperwork done, you know, tax file number, the usual paperwork, but quite straightforward. And I believe we'll be going online hopefully very, very soon, but just talk to us. We'll get the document to you, and you can also get it online, download it yourself. So I think I saw a question earlier.
Yeah, there was one, Jake, about wholesale investor qualifications from Ross. So, Ross, there is quite a benefit if investors can qualify as wholesale investors, because we can show them then a much greater range of bonds, and in fact things like foreign currency bonds open up to them, as do FIG's own new origination issues, which we've been originating, I think we've originated 8 new bonds for mid-sized corporates now, but these are only available to wholesale investors initially, and so there are certain advantages in becoming wholesale. The qualifications are either 2.5 million net assets under your supervision, or $250,000 gross income for the last 2 years. So what we require is a letter from your accountant, and then we can set you up as a wholesale investor. I had a question here from Kenneth, who's asked about Jake's choices for the $10,000. Are they available in $10,000, and are they available to retail investors? I've just flicked back on the screen there. All three of those bonds are available to retail investors. So, and that is part of the part of their attraction as well. There's no distinction there, certainly that Bendigo and Adelaide Bank floating rate bond, in my mind, is particularly good at this point. And if you think about, you know, trying to maximise your term deposit funds, you're probably keeping your funds short, either 3 months or sort of 12 months max, because they're not giving you or not paying much for over 12 months at the moment. Those floating rate bonds, if you think interest rates are going up from here, every quarter they're linked, of course, to that benchmark, and that benchmark is reassessed. And if you thought interest rates were going further or higher from here, you would expect that benchmark to increase as well. So those are, I think, particularly a good replacement for a TD investment. There's a couple of other questions here. One from Ian: do we have a view on the likelihood of CBA not repaying principal in Pearls 3 on the first call date? That Pearls 3, I'm pretty sure, is a perpetual hybrid. But again, I'm not sure, Ian. I would get hold of the prospectus, just double check that. One of the things we like to look at is the cost of funds. So how much is that hybrid costing Commonwealth Bank? Can it reissue a new hybrid that would be cheaper in its place? If that's the case, yes, it's likely to be repaid. The other thing with the hybrids is, will they still contribute to regulatory capital? So the older style hybrids don't have those new clauses, conversion clauses for non-viability or capital trigger involved. Again, there's a bit of a judgment call. I don't have any particular call on that particular security. Jake, do you have any view on that?
No, that's one thing I found, having traded for almost 20 years in all kinds of assets, you really need to, unfortunately, in that hybrid space, the listed hybrid space here in Australia, each one is almost unique. You really have to know your asset inside out and know the terms. They're not, unlike the bond market, which is a lot more structured, and you know, we don't really put up with a lot of extra wild terms. Either those hybrids, you really have to know the individual asset inside out and have to read the prospectus, and because each one is unique. You can try to lump them together in certain categories, but realistically they're individual securities. Liz would probably have some more details, but yeah, have a squiz of the actual prospectus to get a better idea.
Okay, excellent, Jake. Now, I've just got a couple of final questions. So while I answer these, if you have any further questions, please type them into us. Of course, if you don't have the opportunity or you think of something after the presentation, we're always here and always happy to help. But I have two questions from Andrew, who's in Canberra. And Andrew asks, can he open an account online? And also, he talked about meeting the relationship person. Is there someone that goes to Canberra? Well, FIG staff, all of us, are fairly mobile, if you like. Myself, just last week I was in Sydney and Adelaide, and this week I'm off to Perth. But we do have regularly, some of our Sydney staff do go to Canberra and can meet with you, Andrew. Equally, if we don't yet have an account opening online, I know our IT department are working very hard on that, and it is due to launch soon. But that said, if you give us some initial details through, we can pre-populate a lot of the documents to make that easier. So very delighted to say yes, we will come to you wherever you are in Australia, whether it's Canberra or Cairns or Darwin or Perth, we will try and meet with you. So on that note, I don't have any more questions. I just want to thank you all very much for joining Jake and myself today. We're very keen, personally myself, I'm very passionate about the asset class. I do believe it is very protective, whilst paying better returns than term deposits. And certainly, again, thank you for joining us. We are here to help. If you have any other questions or would like any other information, our website does have a lot of information online, and if you have registered, you can see past research reports, and equally certainly suggest that you at a minimum register for The Wire, our weekly newsletter. On that note, I will say, oh, hang on, I'm getting a couple of questions. I was rounding up there. Okay, so Shezi has just asked, how do we make payments for bonds? Bonds, you normally would nominate an account and give us direct debit authority, and on your instruction, only on your instruction, would we take funds from that account to pay for a bond. Equally, all your interest payments would come back into that account. And look, on that note, again, I'm just going to wind up here. I know a few of you have got to be hungry by now. Thank you very much for joining myself and Jake today, and we look forward to chatting with you in future. Good afternoon.